Here we are at Old St. Luke's Church, established in 1765 as a garrison and stockade for soldiers during the French and Indian War. Later became a church during the time of the Whiskey Rebellion, celebrating its 225th anniversary now in western Pennsylvania. So I'm really happy that you're joining me today on a wonderful journey to explore some history in your backyard. I'm out here in the beautiful grounds of Old St. Luke's Church. And when you visit, and I hope you will, make sure that you take a walk through the beautiful old cemetery out here that has the tombstones of the founding fathers of this area, including General Steele and other forefathers that helped make history come alive here in western Pennsylvania.
When you came up here, you may have noticed a small creek down here. It's actually pretty good size right now. There's been lots of rain. It's Chartier's Creek. Now, if you leave the point and paddle down the Ohio, your first big left is Chartier's Creek at the rocks. So then they took their left. This expedition was led by Captain David Steele. I keep pointing over here because that is his final resting place, right here in the corner. You see the American flag and you see the British flag because he served in both the French and Indian War for the British and as a revolutionary soldier as well. Okay, so he came down. He was given the charge by the commander of Fort Pitt to find an outpost. A suitable location for an outpost. Now, right here, again, in this beautiful spot, the creek does something very interesting. Starts in Washington and flows north, and right about down here by the Baptist Church, it does this little curve and then goes north again. So the neat thing about it is that it creates a little promontory, which was a great spot for a garrison and an outpost. They can look down the creek and they can look up the creek. That makes sense. Great spot. So what does that mean for Old St. Luke's? What that means is this was a great place for an outpost and a garrison. A garrison is somewhere around 40 to 100 British troops. And whenever you have that many soldiers, there's a chaplain. And this is the Anglican Church. This is the English Church. And their presence has been here on this site since 1765. If you take a look at our sign, it does say Old St. Luke's Church established 1790. Now, 1790, I just told you 1765. This was founded as an outpost and a garrison, and there were Christian services taking place. 1790 is when there was a first recording of a wooden structure referred to as a church. Now, later we would identify it through other means as it was called St. Luke's. Okay? So 1790, that's pretty old. All right, that's pretty old. The founding families, many of them, as you look around, are buried here. There's a group of four headstones, two large ones, two small ones, about halfway between me and the tree. And that's the Williams family. And Jane Williams she has a marker there. She was the first one buried here on site, 1795. The last buried here is Rachel Nutt Brown, and she is at rest right here, 1960. Okay, 1960. Now, we do have a current burial ground. It's a burial garden. You see a cluster of hedges and some flags. That is our burial garden. and that is still active for urns, for ashes. Okay, so its inurnment is still active. Major William Lee, we're standing on his land. He was given, he fought, again, he's got both flags, so he fought in the French and Indian War, and he was given a king's commission. He fought with George Washington. A king's commission means that's how he got paid. He did not get paid cash. He did not get paid a pension or anything like that. He was given land. He had two choices. He could have 375 acres right here, or he could have 425 acres in Virginia. Again, not too far away. So he thought about it, prayed about it, and he said, this land here is a lot nicer, and wisely chose this parcel here. In 1803, he passed away and willed 10 square rods to St. Luke's. And if you can trace that property along the fence and the back hedges, and that is exactly 10 square rods. All right, welcome again to the interior of Old St. Luke's. Okay, now this building that we're in right now, it was completed in 1852. Up until this point, the structures were all wooden. And what happens to wood, of course, is it deteriorates, it burns. And so when it finally became a wealthy enough church that it could afford stone as its construction material, that's when it took place. So 20 years it took to complete. This is General John Neville's church. Now, John Neville, you will learn more about at your next stop, but this was his church. During the Whiskey Rebellion, he was threatened by the local militia to do two things. They told him, one, to resign, and two, to turn over all of his records, because he was the tax collector in the area. So think about how that went over when his good friend, President George Washington, said, hey, John, I know you're the wealthiest man in the area, but can you please be the tax collector for the tax on spirits? Because those nasty people in your area are not paying it. There are some that were. There were some that were paying as they could, but the majority were not paying it at all because they saw it as unfair. Okay? That one section of the country should have to pay the debt of all 13 states. Okay, that debt came about from the American Revolutionary War. Part of the compromise to get the Constitution ratified was to collectively take on, by the federal government, to take on the war debt from all the colonies that participated. And so now, and the majority of that debt was to pay soldiers. Okay. So here came Alexander Hamilton. You'll learn about him. And he says, I got a great idea to get this revenue collected. And it was a tax on spirits. So if you think about this area, it is a frontier church. It is a frontier community. They are into agriculture. There are a few families that have enough land that they are growing crops to support multiple families in the area and to have a little bit left over. So what they're growing is wheat, rye, barley, those types of grains, which convert really nicely into spirits. And they're going to be able to transport and make more money on a bottle than a wagon full of just wheat. Okay? So through that money, Hamilton said, okay, you're becoming profitable. I think we could take a little bit of that and pay off some of this war debt. John Neville was threatened locally. He had a mansion up on Bower Hill, and that's Providence Point. There is a historical marker there that where they, and it's placed right there where they found the foundation stones of a very large house. So they assumed then that is the location, because the majority of the houses in the area at that time were not that big. So the militia from the area became violent, burned his house down. He actually fled, and the first safe haven he fled to was right here at Old St. Luke's. And then he figured out what to do. Many of the other of his friends and family came into the church, decided what to do, and John Neville actually fled to his other property on Neville Island. The windows are colored glass. They are not stained. Okay, so they were a wealthy church, but they weren't that wealthy. They couldn't afford the stained glasses. So this is colored glass reproduced from how they found it when restoration began. A lot of samples of the glass were laying around. Some were still up in the framework. The only stained glass is right that beautiful descending dove window up in the front of the church. And at the right time of day, and I think we're good. Yes, you could actually see it on the, you could see the orange on the cross that is on the altar. There's a out of place stone right over there. It's kind of pink. Did anybody read the plaque? That's our Jerusalem stone. That's from the Holy City. There is a quarry right outside one of the walls, and it was shipped here and placed right there. There's another one that's not so much out of place, but it has its own marker as well, and that's over here. That came over from England from the Washington family estate. And that was placed in here in honor of George Washington. The beautiful organ. This was manufactured in 1823 by Joseph Harvey's company in London, England. All right, guess what one of the jobs of an altar boy was? What's that? Yeah, pump the organ. Because you need air for an organ to perform. And so you would have to, every Sunday, every hymn, every all through the service, somebody would have to be. So when this poor guy grew up and was buried, he looked like an archer because he had an enormous, like, one arm, right? Okay, anyway. But no, now there's an electric motor and no one has to do this anymore. This has not been an active church since 1930. Renovations began in 1950. The ceiling rotted away. The pews were rotted away. There was a deer family up here. There were barn owls all scattered around and all kinds of rodents and varmints that were in here. And then some people lovingly stepped in from neighbor churches and began the renovation process.
It's so fascinating, isn't it, that this history is in our backyard? And how did you get to be so interested in this local history, Paul?
Well, it happened 6 or 7 years ago, and I was just starting to do living history in this time period. Uh-huh. And I started to look for places in the area that were of this time period historically. And so I just, I knew about Old St. Luke's. I'd been in here for a few services, and I thought, wouldn't it be cool to be a docent for open houses? And that's how it starts.
Right.
I did an encampment out front, and then I must have done a pretty decent job because then they turned around and asked me to be on the board, and I've been on the board now for.
Well,
you're also
listed as the caretaker, or the mm-hmm. is that right? The caretaker of this
operations
mm-hmm. manager of this beautiful treasure. So you also oversee the other activities here as well.
Yeah. Yes. It's mostly done by wonderful volunteers. Our board is active. There are other folks that come in and help out with the weddings and with the concerts. And the operations manager would just kind of do the basic behind-the-scenes things that keep the doors open and keep the grass cut and the hedges clipped and that kind of thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, it's certainly evident that you're passionate about this place, and it's a special place. I have been to the concert series here on Sunday afternoons, and it's a wonderful, wonderful experience just because of the size, and the groups are always very intimate that are chosen for the concert series. So Paul, my last question, and I think a really important question, is how do you keep up this historic place called Old St. Luke's? How do you fund it? And how can people help?
Well, we do not charge for tours. It's always open houses free, but we do obviously accept donations. There's an offertory box in the back for people to make donations. But at least once a year, sometimes twice a year, we do an appeal. And we just contact our friends, and we just ask for their continued support for the upkeep and for the future upkeep of the facility and the building itself and the grounds. And we have some generous folks, but it's always, we're always looking to enlarge that family of friends. And so the best way to do that is to sign in at the back, leave us your email address, and I'll try not to be too pesky, but you will keep up to date with goings on, and you'll learn more about ways that you can help.
That's awesome. So we'll also post that at the end of the show, how you can contact Old St. Luke's and become more active in what's going on here and help support history in your backyard. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have our website, oldstlukes.org. You can look us up on Facebook, Instagram. Oh my gosh, we're even on Pinterest.
Wow, we're at our second stop today on our adventure of history in your backyard. We're in the wonderfully preserved house of John Neville in Collier Township, and just surrounded by all the wonderful things of the way life used to be. We're going to be getting a tour of the house, and you're going to get to see some of the things up close and personal as the way people lived back in the day of the Whiskey Rebellion. So welcome to our second stop on History in Your Backyard, the John Neville House at Woodville Plantation. So how long have you been involved with the activities and the preservation of the Woodville Plantation and the Neville House, Dan?
About 13, 14 years. I got started one day. My wife has been a member here since she's been in high school. And I stopped by to see what all the hubbub and interest on her part was. And they were having the Wayne's Legion soldiers here, which I am also a part of, and another outfit. And I like history. I like the military. And I inquired to one of the gentlemen, and I said, how does one sign up for this man's army? And I've been here hook, line, and sinker for, like I said, 13, 14 years.
That's awesome. So if people wanted to come visit, could you just tell us what hours you're open for the public to come and visit the Neville House?
Sure. We're open every Sunday, 1 to 4 p.m., we are closed January, the first or second week of December, and we reopen in March.
Fantastic. I know you have lots of special activities that you feature throughout the year, and I know there's a big historic market coming up soon. And we're going to post the information at the end of the show today so that people can look up and find out your calendar of events.
Great.
Yeah.
The big event that we're having this month is July 20th and 21st, Saturday, Sunday. It's going to be an authentic 18th century market fair with sutlers. For those of you that aren't knowledgeable, they are 18th century merchants, tradesmen. They will be selling their handmade wares. We will be having 18th century entertainment. In many market fairs in the 18th century, they were very common, and people learned what people died, what people got married, and they would come as a big gathering.
Wow, sounds fun. And now we're going to take a tour of this lovely house, so let's go and check out some of the rooms.
Enjoy.
Thank you. So here we are in the parlor of the John Neville House, and with our handsome docent, Harry Java. And he's going to tell us about this room and the history of the home.
The room we're in is the largest and grandest. It is referred to as the parlor or the drawing room. People question, why do you call it the drawing room? Well, in the 17th, 18th, and even well into the 19th century, when we were done dining, the ladies would leave the room. They would withdraw. So this became the withdrawing room. Eventually they dropped the term with and just called it the drawing room. In Europe today, they still refer to their principal living room as the drawing room. Okay? Now, the room that we're in is furnished in the late 18th and very, very early 20th century mode. On the floor, this is not wall-to-wall carpeting, which would, of course, not be appropriate to the period. It is called Brussels carpeting. It's 2 foot wide strips. Brussels was the place to have your carpeting made in this period. It was a very expensive commodity. This house has no basement under it, and the floorboards are not tongue and groove, meaning you have drafts whistling up in the winter. So you wanted something to help contain the warmth of the room. So we have 20 slaves here who are not working in the fields in the winter. We can take them and teach them to use a needle and thread to sew these strips together to put down on the floor. The only source of heat in here, of course, is the fireplace. And we will not open this room up on a daily basis. We will use it for entertaining, especially in the cold months. We will use it for balls and parties, and possibly after church services down at Old St. Luke's on a Sunday. Now, how did they entertain in that period? We have no electricity, so we have no television, no radio, no laptops, so we have to do it ourselves. Well, one of the ways they would entertain each other were card games. We have in history books and in private journals and so forth, information telling us that plantations would change hands over a game of cards. Amazing, yes. Also in here, we have a pianoforte. It dates to roughly 1810. It is a Clementi. If you know classical music, Muzio Clementi is a name that shows up quite frequently. He wrote symphonies, opera, ballet, all the various forms of music that were popular in that period. Our piano is playable, and it is challenging to keep it in tune. Why? Because it does not have steel strings. It has catgut strings, which are not the intestines of cats, okay? They're the intestines of sheep. Yeah, seriously. I don't make this up. I'm not smart enough. Now, another interesting phenomenon in this room are the windows. Behind me, these windows have etchings in them, and I'd like you to walk over and take a look at them. When guests came, they would take a diamond ring with the stone inverted and sign the windows. Yes. And today we use guest books. In that period, this is what they did. And if you travel in the South to the great houses in the South, you will see this on a lot of the window panes. It's primarily these front two windows.
All right, so our next stop on the house tour of the John Neville House is the passageway. And we're here with Bob, who's going to tell us about what would go on in this charming entry place of the home. Okay, thank you.
So what you would have seen in the late 18th century is the path right here. It was called various different names, Black Horse Path, different names, but it would have come right through here. Back then, the porch wasn't on the house. So the carriage would have come right up to here, basically right in front of the house. You would have stepped off on a carriage stone, and we know there's a carriage stone here because we took this off about 3 years ago and saw a carriage stone. So you would have stepped up on a carriage stone. You would have come into the front entrance of the house. You would have been greeted by a slave. If you were an invited guest, that you would have had a piece of paper from John Neville saying that you were an invited guest. And you would have been taken upstairs to a very fine bedroom, probably would rival any bedroom that you have today. It's very, very nice. And you would have been served dinner that night, your horse would have been curried. If you weren't an invited guest, because John Neville had very many people stop all through the years, a lot of the men that served with him in the Revolutionary War over the years would stop, and they would come to visit just to see how their commander was doing. This is the only thing that we have that we think represents what John Neville looked like. It's a silhouette done by a lady in approximately 1810. It was her remembrance, her recollection of what John Neville looked like. So this silhouette is the only thing that we have. We don't have any paintings or pictures or anything like that. Like you see Jefferson and Washington with paintings and pictures. We don't have anything like that. So that's the silhouette's the only thing we have that shows what he looked like. Very regal, fine-looking young man. And that's the only thing we have that shows what he possibly looked like. These here, if you can see them, ladies, this is Matt Anthony Wayne. That's a war bond from the Revolutionary War. And this is Benjamin Lincoln. These are original war bonds. These are not reproductions. And they would have sold them for about $10 back in that day, which is somewhere around $1,000, $1,200 in today's dollars. And it was a way to raise money. And it was a way to also show people, I'm a man of wealth, I'm somebody, you know, look at me. So they would have posted them on the wall so people could see them when they walked into the passageway and know that they were a man of means or a house of means. Believe it or not, in the 1780s and 90s, they would have had wallpaper and carpet and very fine things that we would consider today in very fine homes. They would have had back then. Obviously, it probably wasn't made in the U.S. It was probably made in Paris or London or somewhere like that and then transported over. But they did have fine furnishings. And we know that because when the second plantation up here, Bower Hill, burnt down in 1794, he wrote to Congress all the things he lost. And he talks about the carpet and the wallpaper in there. So we know they existed. And we think this house is very similar to the house that burnt down. We think it was somewhat of a carbon copy. So more than likely, they had wallpaper and carpet in here, too. So, yeah, that's a misconception. People think that that's a modern thing, and it really isn't. So, like I said, remember, everybody lived in log cabins. You know, probably 90, 95% of people lived in 18 by 18, whatever length of a log was. Probably most of them had a dirt floor. So this would have been Donald Trump's mansion compared to what they lived in. This would have been a fabulous house.
So here we are. We've concluded our tour at the John Neville House and the Woodville Plantation. And I'm with the director here, yeah. Tiffany Appen. And I just want to thank you again for opening the doors of this historic mm-hmm. home to our guests today and our viewers. Mm-hmm. And is there anything else you want to let them know? I know you're looking for volunteers.
Yes, of course. Well, we're always looking for help here, definitely. And you can help out either as a docent, a museum aide, or if that's not really your style, you can help out behind the scenes as well, just for setup for events such as the one we did for you today, as well as some of our bigger events like the market fair that we're going to be having in a couple of weeks here. And also our gardens, the chickens. There's so many different ways people could help out around here. So yeah, so if you're interested, just hit us up. Our website's woodvilleplantation.org. We also have a Facebook page. Find us and like us on Facebook and social media, Instagram. Sign up for the mailing list. You'll be hearing from me a lot if you sign up for the mailing list, because I'm the one that also handles the mailing list. So,
and and you always are sending me lots of interesting things that are going on here at the John Neville House. Mm-hmm. So thank you again.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Now face your partner, join hands, and turn. And turn again.
She's still short for me.
Take your lady for a short walk.
Okay.
Gentlemen, take a short walk. And back to a long walk. This just repeats. This is only 2 minutes, and you don't need to go to the gym after today's dancing experience. Change hands. Continue your long walk. Face your partner, and turn again. And please, do not be waiting. Short walk, gentlemen. And we're back to the long walk. Change hands, continue the long walk. Face your partner, join hands, and turn, and turn. Take your lady for a short walk.
Short walk.
Gentlemen, short walk.
Oh, walk, and turn.
End of dance, bow, and curtsy.